I did come across this wonderful photograph of my grandfather. His name was William Agin, and it made me wonder what fragrance he might have wore. This picture was taken in the 1920s, and you can see he was a handsome fellow. So come with me as I explore in this tag by E, my favorite barbershop scents. Stay tuned. I have to apologize to E for taking so long to do this wonderful tag, but I'm finally getting around to it. So let's start off with something. I'm going to go chronologically. So I'm starting off with the oldest one, and this is from the mid-1700s, and it is, of course, 4711. Now, 4711 is an eau de cologne, and it is quite beautiful, and it's stuck around all these years because it really is a great barbershop scent. I remember as a kid, they used to have a big bottle of this at the barbershop I went to, and they always finished off the haircut with a bit of this in your hair and around your neck. So I've always worn it, and it is really beautiful. Now I use it as an after bath splash or after shower splash. It just sets me up for the day. The next thing on my list is Geo. F. Trumper's Eucharist. This is from 1912. This is a really gorgeous barbershop scent, just really something that is very, very, very classic. As you can see from this beautiful bottle, it is really a treasure in my collection. Then we move to 1916 and the very glamorous and oft worn by many film stars, Acqua di Parma Colonia. And this is, of course, a classic. And I've done a review on it, and you can check that out. But in the meantime, it is one of my favorite barbershop scents. Now, not all of them would be considered classic barbershop scents. For instance, from the 1920s is Nice 10. This is a leather and was often worn by Marlene Dietrich and Jimmy Dean, James Dean, the great film star from the 50s. It is a very strong, very potent fragrance. Now I come to one of my favorite barbershop fragrances, and this is from 1934. And it is from the English House of Dunhill, and this is Dunhill for Men. This one is just magnificent, a beautiful, beautiful fragrance, and will always be in my collection. Then we're going to skip the 40s. Don't have anything from the 40s that is a barbershop scent, but we're moved right into the 1950s, and we start off with from the House of Givenchy. Hubert de Givenchy's very first fragrance for men, and that is, of course, Monsieur de Givenchy. And this one is just a beauty. And I have it in the splash. Oh, just incredible. This one, if you can get your hands on it, it, of course, has been reformulated as most fragrances have, but it is so gorgeous. I'm sure that you'll be pleased with that. Then we move to Ian Fleming's signature scent, which is from the House of Floris, and that is, of course, a Floris number 89. This one I just received recently, and it's become so popular in my rotation this winter. I wear it all the time. I just really can't seem to get enough of this one. Then from the House of Guerlain, we have Abbey Rouge, and this is a beautiful leather, just incredible. And then we move to a lady's fragrance that men can wear. It's an incredible fragrance from the House of Kobachar, and that is created by Madame Gris. This is, of course, the House of Kobachar. It's from the House of Gris, and it's Kobachar. And it is a gorgeous leather. It comes very close in intensity to Nies 10, but not quite as biting. And it's from the 1950s, and it is just beautiful. And you'll notice that there is a bow. You can see that on the bottle. I call it a bow tie. So there you have Kobachar. Then my number one favorite from the 50s and my signature scent for many years from college on, of course, is from 1955. And it is the beautiful original Pour Monsieur by Chanel. Just an incredible fragrance. And oops, and I really, really treasure this one. Then I'm moving, these aren't from the 1960s, but I put them in the 60s because of this particular fragrance, which was worn by John F. Kennedy, President John F. Kennedy, and that is Caswell & Massey's beautiful cologne spray, Jockey Club. This one is a little powdery, but just right there in the wheelhouse of the barbershop. You know, they used to dust this also in the barbershop with a kind of talcum powder. So that's that kind of feeling that you get from that one. Then this one was also from Caswell & Massey. This was actually from the late 1700s, and it's called Tricorn, which is named after the tricorner, the three-cornered hat that was very popular, especially with the colonials in the United States. And this is a beautiful bottle. You can see it. It has the writing of the on the back that says Caswell & Massey, chemist and perfumist. And it is just a really beautiful fragrance. This was very popular in the 1930s with like John Barrymore, Drew Barrymore's great grandfather or great uncle. Now, I forgot to mention one that is also very, very early from 1888. And that is, of course, the father of all men's fragrances. Kind of got men's fragrances going where they began the separation of the sexes and fragrances. And that's the beautiful, from the House of Houbigant, the beautiful, oh, gotta open it. The beautiful Fougere Royale. That is an incredible fragrance. Now this was recreated or reimagined in 2010. And of course I've never smelled the original, but this one just is a magnificent fragrance. A perfect, perfect barbershop fragrance. Now, I'm moving to a very controversial one. This is from the early 70s, 1975. Many people hate it. There have been challenges created around it. This is a fragrance I wore in the 70s, and I think it is beautiful. I beg to differ. I think it is classic, not old man or grandpa, but classic. And that is, of course, Geoffrey Beene's Gray Flannel. To me, this is a quintessential fragrance from the 70s. Beautiful, beautiful barbershop fragrance. I need to do a full review on this, and I certainly will be doing the one shortly. Then from 1978 is the unbelievably dramatic and quite wonderful Pour Homme by Van Cleef & Arpels. This is a gorgeous leather. Just something that I discovered in the late 70s and wore quite often when I wasn't wearing my Chanel. Then we moved into the 1980s and we have another beautiful leather, Santos by Cartier. It was named after the man who, from South America, who became an expatriate, lived in France, and was very instrumental in the creation of aviation. And this was named after him. He also Cartier made the very first wristwatch for him, so he could look at his watch while flying. So this is a beautiful Santos. Then we move back to the House of Chanel, and this one is, to me, quintessential of the 80s, and many people wouldn't think it'd be a barbershop fragrance, but I think it is. It's very bold, very in-your-face, very uncompromising, and that, of course, is Egoist. This is the Egoist, not the Egoist Platinum. This is the beauty of the house for men's fragrances. I just really love this one. Then we have a flanker from the house of Van Cleef & Arpels. That is Czar. It's a flanker to Pour Homme. There you have it in the beautiful green bottle. It's kind of hard to see that that's green. There we go. You can see it's green, just gorgeous. And this is a wonderful fragrance, quite woody. Then into the 90s, this is something I discovered in the 90s when I was out of my Pour Monsieur Concentré at the time, and this came very close, and it is just incredible. This is Glow by Rocha, and there you have the bottle. It is a beautiful, you can see I've worn a lot of this, and this is my second bottle, so this is definitely a popular one in my rotation. Then we moved to the south of France, to the house of Faconable, and this fragrance is Faconable. It's beautiful fragrance. I love the bottle with this little cap that's attached, and you just pop it off like that. Ah, just incredible. They were a clothing house that was very small and intimate in the south of France and discovered by Cary Grant in the 1950s, and probably when he was filming To Catch a Thief. So this came out in the early 90s, and then a beauty that I just love. It's Carven Homme, and there you have the bottle. That is a really great fragrance. I wear this often in the evenings. Just, oh, there's something about this that reminds me of my old Uncle Bud. It is really a wonderful fragrance. Not that it's an old man at all, but it just takes me to memories of my uncle. Now, from another fragrance, this is from Italy. This is Ten Corso Como Homo, and this is very woody, just a beautiful fragrance. I highly recommend this one, just incredible. And this house, no one ever talks about, and it is something that you really should check out. So that's Ten Corso Como Homo. And then we're winding down, something I just received recently and just did a review on, and this is the beautiful Palm Springs by Florist for Spencer Hart. And there you have the bottle. This one, oh, I have to put it on right now. It's just so incredible. Ah, oh, beautiful, beautiful. And finally, last but not least, in this very long line of beautiful barbershop fragrances, is another one from the house of Oubigon, and this is Cologne Intense. This is actually Pure Parfum, and this one is a knockout. It kind of encapsulates the whole tradition of men's barbershop fragrances from the very early 1700s to the present. So that's why I ended with this one. This just came out last year, or maybe it was 2015. It's very recent. But there you have my collection. Now, which one would I say is my absolute favorite? It changes. But I would have to say probably at the moment, Florist number 89. That's my favorite barbershop fragrance. So thank you, Eve, for asking me to do this wonderful tag. This is Lanner Smith from Sense Memory saying, remember, wear what you love and not what they say you should like. Cheers.